IVM.
कृपया ध्यान दीजिए, the language used on the podcast may not be fit for consumption. We warn you, tread carefully. But listen, yaar, don't be so conservative.
Oh my God, yeah, the show is now live. I am Siraj Baruchi. That's my Italian name because it's the one to last night or today morning, depending on where you live. Not that anybody cares except me. However, just want to mention before we get the great Sid Deshmukh on, I want a nice happy story to put him in a good mood and people listening as well as in a good mood. I was thinking that there's just too much negativity out there. We have to have some happy stories. So I got this lovely story I want to share with you. Two snails, it's a true story. Two snails were mugged by a slug. All right, and obviously the police were involved. The police came and questioned them and they asked the snails what happened. And the snails said, you know, to be honest, it all happened too fast. So they couldn't remember anything. Sorry, Sid. This is a true story. I just like the government.
No. That's absolutely fine. You know something really interesting?
Huh.
They found a new species of sub-snails called Varadia or something in the Western Ghats. It happened in the times of India. Yeah, snails, man. Yeah. Snails it is. Escargot.
And is this the one who's going to be named after our martyr who fought off those terrorists, Mr. Omble?
I have no idea.
Yeah, I don't know how they mix and match those things sometimes. I don't think it is as appropriate as people think. But anyway, it is what it is.
It is what it is.
Hi, I'm Zarina Poonawalla, host of the Empowering Series podcast on the IVM Network. I happen to be a peak performance coach and leadership coach by profession, and I'm here to share with you productivity tools, life-altering techniques, and real-life hacks to help you achieve your maximum potential in everything you do, your relationships, professions, careers. So tune in every Monday to unleash your inner power. Be safe. Be well, be empowered.
Before we get on, I want to apologize for two things. One is I've just gone through a really harrowing tragedy. My phone, which I don't understand at all, said it sort of went into blind mode because I get up at 5 in the morning and in the dark, I try to press things. This sounds sexual, but it's not. And next thing I know, it had these green brackets happening and it would not respond to my fingers. Again, sounding vulgar. But so four hours have passed after that. Various people have attempted and failed. Finally, my daughter in Hyderabad, 14 years old, instructed me and got me out of it. And now it's working normally. But I had no idea who was coming on till 6 minutes ago. I couldn't, you know, talk to anyone because we're so dependent on this. So I have to apologize.
Not a problem.
Also, that meant, said a huge problem for the podcast. My second breakfast ran late.
Oh.
It's just come.
What?
It's the veg cheese toast, $35 from Radhaji downstairs. I help his income because poor fellow had no income for many months.
Yeah.
Uddhav Thackeray doesn't care. Nobody's paying for them. Somebody should pay for them. What the hell's going on here? I mean, he's got to feed his family. With the, you'll notice the lovely sauces. This is the famous tidbit. And this is the chutney, green chutney. I don't know if you can see it. Yeah, there you go. There you go.
It looks deadly.
It's deadly. So permission to eat my veg cheese toast sandwich at some point.
Chew. Huh? Chew away.
That's the highlight of our show when we break bread together.
Yeah. That's it. Breaking bread. Yeah. Pow.
Okay. Yeah. Now let's get back to the main reason we are here, which is to celebrate you.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Now, obviously, you know all these things, but there are three people who listen to this show. One of them is a snail, and they need to know everything. Siddharth Deshmukh is popularly known as the traveling professor. We'll come to that because I think that's the second show. Former associate dean at MICA and also first batch MICAN. Is that the right pronunciation? Or MICAN?
Yeah. No, MICAN is probably better.
Yeah, MICAN. MICA mat jaiyo, wo mat jaiyo meri jaan. Smarter with Sid is the first one we're going to talk about because it's on IVM, of course. But this is a little bit about the background. Going back to traveling professor, which really caught my eye, is you travel between London, Pune, Ahmedabad, Mumbai, Edinburgh, Bangkok as well. But obviously in the last 14 months, thanks to this beautiful world that we're living in, was that still possible or were you...
Nah, it just became the grounded professor after, you know, being known as the traveling professor. It was quite...
But
the whole idea was to actually just travel across places and teach and learn a few things. I think that was the life.
Okay, so let's go back now, and we'll start with the Smarter with Sid. But before that, can we go back a little bit into school, college, and try and understand the genesis of the greatness of that made Sid the man he is today?
Oh,
Padma Shri, Padma Vibhushan, Padma Lakshmi. You choose the Padmas. Yeah.
The third one is probably the most tempting, but what I would
say... I'm going to talk about your two daughters at some point. Oh. So whatever is on this podcast will be viewed by them.
It doesn't matter.
And as a father of a daughter, I'm just telling you, there are a couple of things you want to avoid. Because the beating will be horrible that follows.
It's true.
Yes. So going back to school, college, just to understand how you landed up, where you landed up, because that's always the best story of all.
No. See, I was a terrible student. Terrible students make the best teachers. So hopefully I'm a good teacher. And that's probably because I was an absolutely horrid student. The reason why I was a horrid student was because I was interested in playing cricket most of the times. And I ended up playing a decent level of cricket till I encountered...
Everybody, stop it. What do you mean by a decent standard? You played for Pune?
So there's no such thing as Pune in that sense. But I'll tell you, the highlight of and the low light of my career was to get pummeled by Sachin Tendulkar and Vinod Kambli, who were playing on the other side. It was... horror. And this was before he became really big, right? And within a year, he was facing the likes of Imran and Wasim Akram and all of those
89,
guys.
89 November. But so that's when did correct. You play against Kambli and Tendulkar? So I'm Shardashram versus a school it must have been.
So we were playing against Shardashram, and it was one of those games that we got wherein we didn't know who the hell we were, right? We were boys from Pune, and we started playing, and then
know the Mumbai guys on the circuit. Okay.
Yeah. So basically, we just saw the genius that he was at that point in time before, you know. So I got
how good was he then?
He was fantastic, yeah. And one of the most
that straight back the punch and all was there.
No, so he was. See, I think a lot of the power came later. The power because of the thing. But he was really really compact as a batsman, and you could see. You know, there's some players that you can see, and you can say, okay, this is special. This is something else. Kambli was there too, and he was a great.
So the legend is that Kambli was the better bat initially. Is that true, or is that just nonsense that people like to say? You saw it first up. So who impressed you more?
Sachin. Any day, Sachin. For two reasons. One is on the field, because he was just compact and actually beautiful to look at, even as an opposition player. Secondly, he was a phenomenal swing bowler at that point in time. He got selected for the MRF pace.
Dennis Lilly, MRF pace camp. Yeah.
So he was good.
A decent bouncer in the nets, in his later years, apparently.
Then his bouncer was probably even better because, you know, and because he was short, right? It used to skid quite a bit. But that was one. The most important thing about Sachin Tendulkar that I remember was all of us Pune spoilt brats were, you know, complaining about the yellow water that you get to drink. In Shivaji Park, right?
So the fact still there, brown yellow,
brownish yellow, you
correct,
know,
spot on.
So we were like, what the hell is this? And this dude comes in and he just finishes a jug of water like that, right? Just like that. And so one of the guys who was in my team is like, did you not notice what, you know, the taste of the water? And so, the question didn't register and at all to him. He was like, what water? And he just, so it was, it. What I really came, I thought to myself, it really struck me that this guy was so focused. This water and all of that was just completely.
And mentally tough because, you know, it's not an issue.
Irrelevant. It was just irrelevant. Wow. There's no toughness only. So I think that struck me the most. And Kamli was good too, but Kamli, I took Kamli's catch, which was good. I think that was probably the high, and being bowled by Sachin, he kept bowling me a couple of massive in swingers.
So you caught Kambli and you were out to Sachin.
Yeah.
So you left your mark.
Excellent. It was the low light at that point, but now it's a highlight because I can talk about it on your show and shit like that. But
our show is about you and academic pursuits and how to make your brain better and etc. And we've gone into Kambli Tendulkar part two.
I got my lumps very quickly. I decided to move to something else. No. So the fact is that I was a cricketer and I used to I broke my foot and that's why I
bowler. Were you a bowler?
I was a decent all rounder. Yeah, I was a batsman bowler. If there's something on those
batting all rounder. Okay.
Fair enough. So first change bowling. Weird action, but mostly a batsman. So yeah, that was it. Yeah, it was fun. That was my Andy Warhol moment at that point in time. But essentially, I broke my foot at a very tough time in my cricket period. And at that point in time, there was no, you know, rehab and shit like that. So if you broke your foot, you decided, okay, chalo bhai, padhai karte hai. So I gave my cat, I got through Mica. And so I became a first batch Mica.
For the uninitiated, yeah. When he says nonchalantly that I did my cat and gave it, it's that doesn't really add up. You have to have a certain level of intellect to do cat. You can't just blame it on injury. Let me tell you, I know lots of people are still doing cat from my batch. So yeah. To dwell on a second on that, because I'm also a cricket tragic and I see you definitely are. But deep down, what would you have given to be, out there with Kambli and Sachin in the next round of Indian cricket as, you know, under-19s and then university and next thing.
100%. Teams that's, and, yeah. That's
for a second,
dream,
that,
right?
that must have been, that's, yeah, I am just playing in our backyards. Oh, yeah, man. Yeah. But you got it. I mean, I bowled to Gavaskar once at the Bombay gym. You know, I mean, he just wanted people to throw balls at him. It was not even like a proper formal bowling. But I felt like a god because I hit the pad. Yeah, I mean, the ball was a gusru. It just, you know, it went back and went down and it hit the bottom of his pad. Yeah. And of course, he looks at me, winks, and says, "Not out."
Yeah. No. So I was like really fortunate to do that. And the second time I met Sachin and Vinod Kambli and not Vinod Kambli but Azharuddin and all was when I was an executive at Sony Entertainment Television.
Wow.
So that was my first job of Mica and yeah, and guess who I meet? I meet Sachin again. And
did you bring it up?
No.
You may remember some of these guys are fantastic with their memory for school games and you know, the early years especially.
I think I
would have done it, especially if he got your wicket. Because you know how they are. Batsmen who wanted to be a bowler, so that he won't forget.
I didn't want to remind him of that.
Sachin, you changed my life. Today I'm a super successful guy thanks to you. Why are you playing club cricket, Anga League F or something for some small bank somewhere in the middle of nowhere with no bounce in the wicket? Okay, listen, 100%. We hijacked this on cricket. Let's move away from cricket. We have to talk about all the other things. So cricket's loss in a sense meant that you obviously put your mind more into academics. You got into CAT and you know the CAT, etc. And then what happens?
So I joined Mica, I passed out of Mica, I joined Sony Entertainment, I left Sony Entertainment, I went to AT&T before it became Idea 3G, 4G, 5G and left that. Then I went over to the UK and I became an entrepreneur, started a digital agency before they were known as digital agencies. We got out of that business, did a few more. I set up a pretty decent life for myself and my family. We moved there in 2003, 2004.
So that was the startup boom, the part one, was it not? Around that time?
Yeah, absolutely. So the whole, so I thankfully I missed all the bust part, but the boom part helped me. Huh. And I had, I guess, a little more money and little sense at that, a little lesser sense, more money. So I decided to get into academics and write books and stuff like that. So because I, beyond a point, it just did not mean anything to me.
Let me understand. So the startup did so well that you now your self actualization happened and you said, "Mere ko aur kuch karne ka life mein." Is it that what you're saying?
No. So obviously, I did not reach the Richard Branson variety of success. But the fact is that I did reasonably well. And I, even though I was doing well, it was not something that was fulfilling me. So I wanted to actually explore some other things. So I started off as a visiting faculty, then I became an adjunct professor. Then I became an associate dean and now I'm the traveling professor. So that's the thing. I also tried to write a few things like books. Please don't read my books. They're terrible. So I don't think I can write at all. But I wrote a couple of books. So I did a little bit of that midlife exploration happened to me about a decade or two earlier than what it normally happens. So that's the backstory.
Back in London, did you get distracted when you passed Middlesex Ground, Lords, Oval, Surrey? Did you get distracted for a minute over India is touring and all? I mean,
you know, just last year, I played a Village Greenwala game, and it was such fun. I'm telling you, because you dream of those things, right? So the Village Green and all of that.
Yeah, what we read about, absolutely.
Yeah. So that's what happened.
And it is amazing that they have these, I played a couple of games there also, and it's just like, there's no budget or anything for anything, but the quality of life is so good. You've got this nice ground, you've got this perfect place to bat on, you've got proper equipment. We've all grown up with one pad.
Yeah.
You know, remember the old days, you bat with one pad, you happy to we used to share, we don't get into it how bad we were.
Absolutely.
And gloves to left-hand gloves bhi chalega. Tough to hai na?
Absolutely.
We'll do it some or the other. And then you come to these guys, they are not even professional cricketers, they're just playing for a lark and everything's perfect.
And they've got, you know? And the funny thing is that they're drinking beers and
yeah!
it's a good life.
That's why we beat them. It's a fun game. Yeah. We Indians take it more seriously. It's cat all over again when you play cricket. Yeah. Cool. So then you went towards your academic pursuits because you said, I need to do something else. Money's not everything. Mm. And then we find you. So that's your thing now.
Mm. Yeah. That's my thing.
It's like preaching is a terrible word to use. To spread the gospel of enlightenment in a sense.
No, yaar, aisa kuch nahi. But I think that actually I'm inspired by people like you. You know, I'm going to call, say, people like you, meaning comedians or stand-up comedians or funny people or
that's
whoever.
Very generic. That's like saying I like humanity. That's fine. Because that's huge. There's 50,000 comedians in the country. And no, yeah, okay, from that whole tribe.
I just think that there is a certain amount of, to be honest, when you're learning something, when you're learning something, the best way to learn something is if you're in a relaxed frame of mind. And most of the teachers that I encountered were terrible. They were horror.
this is going on a podcast from the beginning. I feel bad now. Okay, we just had a history sort of podcast with William Dalrymple. And every time the questions and the people talking and whatever interactive you do, it's always criticizing the teachers. Sometimes I feel really bad. Like they just didn't do their job personality-wise to engage you in a subject. More than not their intellect or their academic qualifications, all great. Mm. Just not the right personality to teach.
I
don't know. Maybe that's what you're trying to say in a sense, that teaching is not just about what it is.
Yeah.
It's about getting people interested.
Yeah, it's the there's a difference between the words curriculum and pedagogy. So curriculum is what you're teaching. Pedagogy is the way in which you teach it. So if I look at the way in which you teach things, it's probably you need to be a bit of a theater artist or nowadays film artist or whatever, because that's what is required. Most of the times,
the drama.
Yeah.
The drama of statistics, for example. There's some subjects that would be really hard, bro. Mm. I'm just thinking. I'm sure history actually is good because, you know, it's replete with its action and stories and, you know, all kinds of intrigue and treachery and all that.
Yeah.
But when you look at, like, maybe geography sometimes or even physics at its very bare essence, you know, I mean, refraction, reflection, kya kare ho uske saath at the end of the day? You can't show me naked girls and say, look, she can see her in the mirror or something like that. I don't know. It's tough. Some of the subjects are tough. Let's be honest.
Yeah, they're tough. But I think that they can be made interesting. They can't be made simpler, but they can be made interesting. And I think a good teacher is able to probably do that most of the time.
How come? But you have no connection with cricket, that being your real love. I was thinking that somewhere down the line, when you're looking at your life and what we want to call this a midlife crisis or the point where a male looks at his life behind and forward, is it kya karega abhi? You didn't think maybe I can, you know. I mean, there are IPL teams, there are club teams. You could buy a team somewhere down the line somewhere.
Yeah, sure. That certainly, I mean, you've got to know what
Pune team will be up for auction now.
First, Pune team. Second, you know, what the hell? I don't think you know what a professor actually makes in life. I did start something really interesting, Cyrus. You might like this. In 2011, when we won the World Cup under Dhoni, I started something called Between Overs because I realized that Between Overs is where everybody is an expert, right? So I actually started the world's first social commentary site on cricket. And this was way before things became big. It was where everybody could be a Harsha Bhogle and everybody could give gali galoches. And I'd done the whole interface and I put it up there and it became quite popular for a while. I was doing it because I was on a sabbatical at that point in time, again, trying to figure out how to move ahead. But the success of it really astounded me. And today, of course, you'll have these chat functions and you have your Great Cricketer. I don't know if you listen to Great Cricketer, but that's pretty good too.
That's great. Yeah. So I totally understand, because instead of arguing at the water fountain or in the family dining table or whatever, you can actually get it out there if you think you're a pundit. Or I think we Indians like to express ourselves when it comes to cricket.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now we just segue for a second since you keep bringing it up. Shubham Gill goes back. Huh. We don't have we already have Ishwaran there, who's unproven, but they've invested in him as an opener. You got KL Rahul, who they keep saying now they don't want to keep him as an opener, but he's played as an opener for the last couple of years almost, and he's there. And the middle order is stacked, so there's no place for him there. So is there a need to send Prithvi Shaw and possibly Parikal and who knows what from a so-called B team in Sri Lanka or somebody from India? You've got enough manpower. Shouldn't we just go with what we got?
I've always suspected KL Rahul's soft dismissals. So I'm a little concerned about the way in which he would actually play in tough situations. In England. I'm not sure. He's a very talented bat, like most of them are at that level. But if you just see 10 last dismissals of his, it's never been, it's very soft. I'm not sure about Prithvi Shaw. I think that he certainly is very talented. To send him out there, I think the BCCI has got enough money to get people out there for teams to play against each other and stuff like that, right? I mean, that's what we did before.
That's all we have at the moment. We are Indians in England. We can't touch or talk to anyone. Yeah. We have to play amongst ourselves and stay in a camp.
Yes, yeah. And because everybody else is playing soccer. So,
and they've got 60,000 people in Wembley. They're worried about us.
I know.
Let's see how that plays out.
I know.
No, so my point is, so then we've already got, okay, so you say you don't want to invest in KL Rahul with a moving ball.
Yeah.
Okay, fair enough. You got Ishwaran already there with Rohit Sharma.
Mm.
Or maybe a Pujara goes to open and you put somebody else at three. Or you won't touch. You won't touch three, four,
see,
five.
If I was, so to be honest, if I look at, if I was Kohli, I would think in terms of Rahane and Pujara and probably drop one of them.
No, just think not in England, Baba.
Just think about
quality bats.
Just think about the speed. I mean, the length of innings.
You don't remember his 100 in Melbourne against the run of play, the way, what character he showed, yeah?
Wonderful character, 10 tests ago.
What kind of Maharashtra are you? Do you have no feeling? What the hell? You know how India is divided? The record is not great in terms of statistics.
Punekar's criticize each and everything, man. You should know that about Punekar. Yeah.
No, I do. I'm told the finals are between the Bengali Brahmin and the Pune Brahmin.
Correct.
You put them together for the final of not actually doing anything but knowing the subject, be it sports or science or whatever. Yeah. Am I right?
Yes, exactly.
I will watch this show. We have all the communities are full of themselves, and then at the end, it's the Bengali versus the Punekar. Boom, I will watch this show. It's like a cricket match.
That's partly the reason why I'm a teacher, right? Because you gotta be able to.
You gotta take it. I won't take it out of the family. You gotta take it out of somebody else. Yeah, show them the path. You know, I was just a little disappointed that they take boys there and then don't allow them to play. And you take somebody else from outside, it just kills the confidence of whoever's there. You've invested in 20 guys. Those 20 guys work for you in the oldest 14, 15, 16 member squad. Yeah.
I buy your point.
What you said, Prithvi Shaw's performance in white ball cricket, superb last 3-4 months.
Yeah.
You know, he's broken all the records and most runs in a 50-over domestic game, etc. But how does that translate into red ball, Duke's ball in August against maybe, they may have Archer back. They'll definitely have...
You know who Prithvi Shaw reminds me of? Prithvi Shaw reminds me of Kamli.
Oh, okay. Are we talking about temperament?
Temperament.
Yeah. Yeah, it looks like there's a few issues there, yeah.
Something about him. Just that whole body language, business, haptics, whatever you want to call it. There's something there.
Yeah, you're right. I also feel it's a mental thing, you know. Too much, too soon.
Something.
Wrong people around him. A lot of people talk about that, you know. Because otherwise, sometimes when he's batting, he reminds you a little of Sachin, a little bit of Viru.
No, he
plays those classical shots. Of course, Sachin's influence is like a dragon over everyone.
Yeah.
And they all like to play that punch, that straight punch. But that's like a sign of a really, you know, like you said, compact batsman who you know is balanced well. When you see those kind of shots through the covers.
You can recognize that grace and beauty anywhere, right?
Yeah.
I mean, whatever field you are in, you know that, okay, this guy, in this, that's his stage. You know, that's what he does.
And only you and I can have this conversation. All the people who are on the show with us have already put it off. My wife walked away from the conversation and all. When the two cricket tragics start getting into the poetry and romance of the game, in the way he lifts his bat and it goes from extra cover all the way to let's get back to your life. So now smarter with Sid. Oh God, it's 10:23. Smarter with Sid.
Okay.
So. Which is why we're here and we spent 22 minutes discussing Kamli. So we need to... Whose fault is that?
Huh. We need to get smarter. Yeah, I think we need to get smarter with our time.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So give us a small dose on what it IVM podcast is very proud to present. Aap pesh karte hain smarter with Sid. This is a generic voiceover everyone should have.
I genuinely think that it is bound to have those sad memes that are going to plague me for the rest of my life. Like, here's dumbass.
It sounds like a Bollywood thing. Yeah. It sounds like the newer Bollywood, you know, these young guys making films today who have these very westernized names.
It but started of course, off with Wake Up Sid, no?
Wake Up Sid.
So something like that, yeah. No, but I think that it was inspired by the fact that, you know, there's this stupid thing that goes on saying, don't be the smartest person in the room. You know, because, you know, a smart person allows other people to speak and shit like that. But I don't buy that. Most of the times, I don't buy that. Because people are there and they're listening to you and you probably got that position because you're the fucking smartest person in the room. I understand that there is an ego bit there which you need to avoid and there should be empathy and so on and so forth. So I'm giving all my political correctness something. But if I look at what I can do whenever I'm going into a room, I can be 1% smarter than what I was yesterday. So, and I don't think that people really understand being smarter is not about being a smart aleck. It actually is about, you know, knowing something a little more, doing something a little better by that 1%, which tends to give you that sort of edge wherever you are. So I think
But isn't it also that, like, if you don't believe you're the smartest guy in the room, how do you expect to fool the other five? In a sense, you know, you come in with like mere paas doubt hai and all that. Why should Mr. Sen Gupta, Mr. Sharma give you? Yeah, I mean, like, you don't even believe in it.
Mr. Sharma is getting ulcers.
The other thing I was thinking for, I thought initially that the Socrates comment was just like flippant, you know, it's funny, witty. Mm. All I know is that I know nothing. Mm. But I think now when I think about it a lot, I think that's a pretty wise comment in the sense that, you know, it keeps everything open for change. Yeah. What you think is correct on Monday is not correct on Tuesday. I think that's what you're also saying slightly. There's a little improvement that happens. And then on Wednesday, you realize you could have been better than what you were on Tuesday because whatever, something dawned on you. But how does one... is there a way to harness that? I think we Indians are always about kaisa karega, you know, how to open the box and get the magic formula out. I think that's a very big thing with our middle class minds in India.
Yeah.
So I presume that's what people are looking for.
Yeah. No, I think that there are two kinds of facts. Facts that lead you to the truth and facts that lead you to utility. Facts are always superseded by facts that change things. Like you talk to physics and, you know, quantum physics kind of replaced mechanical physics. And then, you know, even the great Einstein was proven wrong. So if I look at all the facts that I know today and share with people today, if I claim them to be the truth, then I'm doing people a disservice. But if I tell them, and it's, I think Yuval Noah Harari, the guy who wrote Sapiens, actually said that facts...
Yo, I love that book. Yeah.
Facts lead to utility. Facts should always lead to utility, not truth. So if I can actually allow people to, and utilities are of two kinds. One is the hack that you're talking of. How do I know that? The simple hack, the
get better.
Fixing And Indians are damn good at that whole Jugadu thing. Correct. The second is social utility. So there's functional utility and there's social utility. Social utility is where you can actually stand out and then Mr. Sharma and Mr. Mishra can say, okay, this guy seems to know what he's saying because he clearly knows a little more. So why don't we give him that chance? So I think I think those were the two things that I kept in mind when I was doing this particular brainstorming about the name of the show and what the show should be about.
Okay. So then let's go back. The earlier show was Traveling Professor's Diary, is it?
Yeah. It was also with IVM. In fact, we started off as the Traveling Professor's Diary. So the whole idea was that here I am, you know, traveling from my car to SPGen to... some consulting in Bangkok or to London and teaching in Southampton.
Arre, sir, Bangkok mein consultant nahi tha. I know what you were doing in Bangkok. But because I'm going to discuss your daughters in 5 minutes, I'm going to leave it there.
No, I wish. Oh. But
see, I have a lot of Punekar friends. The one thing the Punekars that I grew up with have in common with the fact that they know everything about everything is that nobody puts their hand in their pocket. So you have to, the answer is that, sir, ye kharch ki baat hai isme to. I don't know.
The big thing about those COVID arrests because people flouted quarantine was people came to realize that this guy had actually gone to Bangkok and then got arrested or something. that was a big joke during the rounds a few months back, right?
True story. Beautiful. These are the is like my stupid snail story. I should have set up the show with this story. This is a beautiful story. Slice of human. I mean, this is the kind of humanity that makes you proud to be an Indian and a human being.
Yeah.
Sorry. So, Traveling Professor's Diary is anecdotal, is it? More?
It is. It is about, you know, if you're a good teacher and if you're going out of class, then students actually, they've changed from my time. So they actually come out and want to have a conversation with the professor.
I hope the same ones aren't there.
They are. Yeah. So then you go to a cafe and have a chai or a sutta or whatever it is. And you're actually having this conversation, this post-class conversation with the student. So that leads to smartness, that actually leads to the best teaching moments, to be honest. And that was the genesis of the Traveling Professor's Diary.
And comes back to your point of relaxation. You've relaxed.
You're really relaxed and stuff like that. But the fact is that most people thought it was a travel show. So it wasn't.
Okay,
it wasn't.
Until I read a little further, it's so did I, because the title is very, why would you put traveling in it? I mean, generally speaking.
No, because my Instagram handle is The Traveling Professor. I'm on LinkedIn. I'm The Traveling Professor. So I thought, chalo, Traveling Professor's Diary. And little did I know that people expected me to climb Mount Everest or go to Borneo in the jungles of Borneo and report.
To survive Vietnam. Yeah.
So I think that was one of the reasons why I wanted to appeal to a larger audience. I wanted to make sure that the promise of the show, whether it's an after-class conversation or whatever it is lies with Smarter With Sid. So I've just made the show a little truer to what its premise is.
So it's evolved in a sense. We've got
it's evolved.
We've got phase one, and this is like phase two, and there's a phase three coming up as well after this.
I'm sure there's a phase three that'll come up. Absolutely.
But the saying is, if we don't evolve, we die. Do you believe that or what? I mean, I don't know. Sometimes I think you get behind the ball and just play straight for the whole day. Hmm. And that's how you save the game.
Yeah.
But then look how cricket has changed in the last 10, 15 years. I mean, you and me are part of that generation that's seen it just go from red ball to all this.
No, that's why I have no patience for people who are stuck in the past, especially professors. Because professors, when they come and present outdated material or outdated case studies, just get my goat, because they're not connected to what's happening. And I think evolution is a fact of life, and evolution is something which we need to do. I mean, cricket, you said correctly, you know, it's evolved from across formats and stuff.
Old order change it.
Yeah.
I would have asked you a question there, sure. Gavaskar or Tendulkar? Because one for the ages, and of course Tendulkar, now we have Virat, then there'll be somebody else, so it's not like it's ever going to end.
I like Tendulkar, because for natural genius, he beats Gavaskar
in dominance and all, no doubt. But did you see Gavaskar's 90 ball 100 against Marshall and company in Delhi?
I would, sir. See, the greatest test innings I've seen is still VVS Lakshman's, 280 plus.
Agreed. Yes. Absolutely agreed.
So the fact is that you need to separate the innings from the cricketer and also like that. See, in Tendulkar's era also, there were good bowlers, right? Like Steyn was there. This guy was there. Akram was there.
All of those guys. At his best. Brett Lee. Curtis Andrews. Scotty Walsh.
So I think we are very nostalgic about the past, and Gavaskar was amazing, right? And he was very inspirational. The one thing that I dislike about both of them was that they used to play it safe. They've played it safe in their career. So both Gavaskar and so they had this mentality. It's an amazing mentality
that's Mumbai school of cricket. Huh? You just Mumbai, don't give your wicket, whatever happens. The situation is, the wicket is...
Correct. Correct. So, which is where I really love Kohli or some of the, some of the younger, newer players. Started with Sehwag, I suppose. I think there's lots to admire about both Gavaskar and Tendulkar. But I would prefer Tendulkar, maybe also because I've played against him and I've seen him up close and
personal. Because you got out to his quicker one.
And if I'd gotten out to Gavaskar, then I would have gotten depressed. Yeah.
He's got Zaheer Abbas's wicket, if I remember correctly, and he opened the bowling a couple of times to let the spinners come on in the old days.
Have you seen that ball and have you seen that video? Man. Zaheer Abbas, I don't think he would have slept for 10 days.
How did he get out? Silly point.
It's terrible. And he tried to whack it, and it was some cat at mid-on or something. It was very bad. It was a terrible, terrible dismissal.
So Gavaskar was even more embarrassed than Zahir.
I think he was probably delighted and embarrassed at the same time.
Wow. Yeah, man, really. Okay, let's take a break and we'll bring in the one and only Silvery. Our break is 3 to 4 seconds. Okay. So I can start eating my sandwich. The Grand Prix, MasterChef Australia, Ricky Ponting, Shane Keith Warne, the Melbourne Cricket Ground and Kangaroos. Now, those are all the things I think about when I think of Melbourne, Victoria and Australia. But did you know that the tech sector in Victoria is growing rapidly as well? So tune in to the new show, Global Victoria Tech Talks. And now I'll do that in my new Aussie Melbourne-ish accent. Tune into the new show, Global Victoria Tech Talks, where they share some amazing and compelling tech stories coming out of Melbourne and how the Victorian government is helping nurture and support the edtech and gaming industries there. Tune into the show on IVM Podcast app, website, or wherever and whatever you get your podcast from. The show is presented by Global Victoria, the trade arm for the Victoria government in Australia. Australia. Oh, let me do that again. Australia. Okay, Australia. Australia, Australia. Victoria government in Australia. Follow me at Instagram and Twitter on Bored Brocha. I'm so bored, I need your help. I need your love. I need your touch. Okay, just follow me. Silvery, come in. Sid is waiting for us. Quickly, and we will discuss. Your daughters are superstars, apparently. 600,000 on Insta, 2 million on... Okay, apparently is the wrong word. Definitely. So, how did that happen? With the guidance of the great philosopher king himself or on their own?
No.
Because the subjects may be different. Yeah.
No. My daughters do not think I know anything about digital. So, even though I might be teaching a lot of digital subjects in many places, they think I know shit. So that, I think, and that's what made them succeed. I think that the fact that they're not listening to me and then they're doing their own thing. So, but I think influencers are of two or three kinds, right? I mean, if you're a Cyrus Brocha and if you've done as a child artist, you've done Jalwa and then gone ahead and you've become a celebrity of sorts. And then you start being on Instagram. Then you're a celebrity who's bringing their influence or fame onto Instagram or wherever. But if you're, let's say, a domain expert like Sanjeev Kapoor or somebody like that, then you're in a different camp as an influencer. But the third influencer, that is something, this is really interesting. Like, that's where maybe my daughter Sara and Avni fall in, and somebody like PewDiePie falls in. So basically, no discernible talent. They're idiots. But the fact is that they have the ability to be natural born communicators and be very good at that. And so first of all, when I saw them getting fame, I was perturbed as a father, but then obviously
why
I was like, what the hell is happening, man?
Were you jealous?
Jealousy is there every day. I mean, come on. The speed at which they're growing.
You rub your face in it, Dad. 10,000 more.
Just keep quiet. Right? Just sit in that corner sort of thing. But the fact is that after the father in me calmed down, and so the professor jagrut ho gaya, I said, okay, so yaar, ye kya ho raha hai? What is happening? So then I checked their community and... they have the ability to build a community. And I'm referring back to Sapiens and Yuval Noah Harari again. And one of the reasons why we probably have natural born communicators they're leaders of a certain kind. And the reason why that they're leaders is because I don't think that in the human species, you're the fastest. So if you're a lion, the strongest lion wins, the wolf, strongest wolf wins. I think in human beings, the ability to communicate actually separates, to naturally communicate, separates you as a leader because you have the ability to band a tribe together. And so therefore, it's genetically in us to actually look towards leadership. And the good thing about humanity is that we have different kinds of leadership. So you have, and it plays out in school as well.
See, boy, you're saying that it's a genetic, a DNA, leadership is in your DNA.
I think leadership, or rather your ability to communicate, okay, and connect to a tree.
Which results in leadership.
It results in leadership because that's one of the primary functions of what a human being does, because that's how we won over the landscape, right? We created, we formed tribes, we thought through our prefrontal cortices and made...
Cognitive functioning, huh?
Yeah, exactly. So I think that there's a big premium, and I think that there's different types of communication in different types of moments, right? So if I look at, you know, even in a school, you'll have people who decide, okay, party kidhar hai, so this guy is the party guy. So kiske paas notes.
That's true.
So note.
Yeah. There's a leadership label. So, that's a very good point.
There's a
leadership label. This is the party guy. This is the guy who studies hard.
You sports guy. Yeah.
Sports guy. Yeah. That's true. Only some of us are the nothing guy. The nothing guy, no much importance will be, but it happens in the future. Silvia, are you following all this?
Yep.
Words of wisdom.
Yes.
No,
I mean,
words.
Kind of.
Have you tuned out? You've tuned out to the two professors. But anyway, I think it was a classical point you mentioned about your daughters again, which is just a natural ability to communicate, which they don't even know they have when they have it initially. And then it comes out because people take to them. Yeah. Because they just feel they're real and what they're doing is real and the identification with them is real.
Yeah.
And I think that's, I mean, if everyone knew how to do that, we'd all have 8 million followers, but obviously we don't.
Yeah, so that's the thing, right? Because that there's a premium to that. Because you have to be able to connect to my emotions across a camera and be able to drive my behavior in such a way that, you know, gives, and you have to give me that attention. So that is huge. You know,
and over a period of time, it's not even a one-off.
No, it's not.
Yeah.
It's not. So that's why I think, that's why I always like to teach my classes, not about influencer marketing, but about influence marketing. Because I think there's a big difference there. So how do you create influences is probably going to be the name of the game moving ahead. You know, because we see advertising going low. We see people getting more and more sophisticated towards, you know, reacting towards advertising. So, you know, marketing rules themselves are changing. When people like us get sophisticated and start skipping every fucking YouTube ad that comes simple, our way.
But there's a simple way out of all this. The old Goldspot way, yaar. Just give us some prize. Mm. Just say, collect the crowns and you will get some 70 rupees. Finish. Mm. You do that and I'm on board again. They don't do that anymore. The simple jugaad of bribery. I believe that's the best way forward for marketing.
I'm sure you collected all those Bagheeras.
I collected all. Said I used to play that lottery like a loser. I mean, you know, ever since I saw the film Naseeb, I went and used to collect the lottery from down, and every time, every week or month, check, including the Maharashtra Raj lottery ka fal aaj nahi to kal. That kal just kept on. I would actually tell my mom that, so again, lottery aaj nahi to kal, but kal never happened. Still waiting.
There's something about those damn jingles, right? That was there in the past. I still remember a very sad jingle. Aage hai mango parsi, piche hai mixed fruit parsi, aju baju milk masala parsi. I don't know why I remember that, but it's there. I'm sure I've never had that stupid candy
that's
in my
that's
life.
That's a tragedy. You love the jingle or it's stuck in your head, but you never ate the product, or you know the product never got anything out of it.
That is
discussing it on a podcast right now. The product
know.
Doesn't exist. Yeah,
I know. That's meta.
That's too much. Too much information. You're giving us too much. You can't digest so much. It's like a pancreatic issue now. I can't take it on.
But you said something about incentivization. And you're right. I mean, there's influence, there's incentivization, and then there's education. Education is where advertising also falls in, right? But if I look at what, and you're so right, when it comes to the short term, you want to change human behavior, you incentivize. And incentivization is not necessarily only positive, right? It can also be negative. Like, for example, during the first lockdown last year, I'll ask you why you stayed home. Now, Modi ji did the bartan business and that was also good.
It changed my life.
That was influence, no? So people who are like, I'm being politically neutral, that was influence. For a certain sect of people, that was influence. But you and I did not get out of our homes because we knew that we'd get whacked on our ass by police with dandas. Now, that is a certain kind of negative incentivization that stops you from doing something. Positive incentivization is, you know, your lotteries and gold spot tickets. So normally in short term stuff, Cyrus, the jugadu in Indians wakes up and so therefore we go for incentivization. In the medium term, it is influence. And in the longer term, it's education. That's why professors are the least paid.
You're like a mutual fund. Your payment will come later. Because you're doing the third part of the trilogy and that comes later. So your payment also comes later. I think that's fair.
Delayed gratification for everybody.
Delayed gratification. But also the delayed spiritual awakening happens. Now, so it should be at the same point, parallel to a cause, both of them. So now, and Sid, apparently you have lots of money, so don't say that. You're going to buy the Pune team when they start bidding in January. So we'll see. Sid will be in charge of a whole team and he'll give Vinod Kambli a job again, I think. Yeah,
I think he already has a job. By the way, do you know
MIG.
Yeah, they're doing well. I think that's a pretty smart move.
I'm so happy that Salil Ankola has come back.
Yes,
you know.
Yes,
because he was one of my favorites. He didn't get his due. What a fabulous bowler! He went through a little bit of a bad time personally, etc., etc. But he's a lovely guy. And I don't want to say this, but we've drunk together, which was half the problem he had, and we had such a great time. Because he's one of those guys,
Salil.
Salil, lovely. And what a good bowler he was.
He was a good bowler.
This is the Kapil Dev era. Raju Kulik. Look what we had in Mar. We had Ravi and Raju. Okay, Ravi wasn't fast. He was
swinging. This is where the
Salil, Pune, Abhi Kuruvilla.
This is where the Punekar and me will tell you that Salil Ankola is a Pune guy.
Well, Ankola technically falls somewhere else, na? Where he comes from.
He started his career with Maharashtra and he took a 5-wicket haul on debut versus, I think, Mumbai or somebody. And
yeah, versus Mumbai, I think.
Yeah, and then
there's a famous Shivaji Park story about Sachin versus him in the nets.
Yes.
You know, where he bounced Sachin and hit him on the helmet or hit him on the shoulder or something. Yeah. And then the next two
he was quick.
Went into Mahim Creek.
Yeah.
Yeah. He was quick. Yeah, but you don't bounce the greatest. You bounce the greatest. It's probably, you know, that suddenly he wakes up. Yeah. You know, That's a tough one. Anyway, let's go to the AMAs. Otherwise, you'll only talk cricket and Silvery hates the game. Silvery, Italy won the semi-final, by the way, since you don't care about football.
Oh, okay. He cares.
Penalty shootouts. He likes girls. We have something, but no sport. Okay.
Cool. Should I get to the AMAs? Yep. The first one comes in from Bruce Wayne. He says, both Cyrus and Siddharth are active podcasters. Taking a moment to self-reflect, please be serious, Cyrus. Tell us some lessons you have learned and mistakes you made as podcasters.
I like, actually, Sid has answered this for me, which is that all the fun things, not fun things, whatever you do in life, if you're relaxed, you're at your best. Whether you're performing, whether you're writing, I'm talking about myself, whether you're, you know, working out, walking my dogs. The best time I have is when the body is, and relax doesn't mean that, you know, you're just not active. Relax, how do you explain it? It's a state of mind, but you don't have that anxiety. You're just in a very good place. And so for me, all these things, I have a partner called Kunal Vijaykar, who's more, we work together well because he's interested in all the extras. The lighting, the look, my tooth is chipped, my hair is bad. Those things he'll concentrate on. I'm always the meat and potato guys. I just want to have the conversation. I think that's the podcast. So he handles that and I would handle this. And so I don't know what's right or wrong. I don't know if there's ever any right or wrong. As you yourself said, Sid, things change between today and tomorrow. But I think that relevance of being relaxed in a real sense for any art form or any creative form or even perhaps a business or anything else, I mean, that's so undervalued.
Yeah.
And that's why I hate it when people come and say, we have to finish the shootout by 5. They immediately have the wrong attitude.
Yeah.
The attitude is not to bring out the best. You're not to stress people. And that doesn't work with 80% of the people because they're already now feeling scared that, oh God, we won't be able to manage. There's too much work, blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
So I love the leaders who come on and say, hey, this is going to be a great day. Let's play cricket for 5 minutes.
Yeah.
And then we start.
Yeah, no, you know, absolutely.
So we have Francis Drake continued playing pool while the Armada was at the, you know, the waters outside and the guys are panicking and saying, so Francis, what do we do? And he says, let me finish. And so he finished the round and then they blew up the Spanish Armada. Because, you know, he was cool, relaxed. Yeah.
That's Bruce Wayne would probably appreciate this.
Please take it further. Yeah.
I would double down on what you said, Cyrus. And you know what? It is a difficult thing to stay relaxed, especially when the stakes get high. I think most people don't actually appreciate this and they think that it comes naturally, but sometimes you have to kind of gear yourself into a state of relaxation. And in fact, the more tough the situation is, that doesn't mean don't prepare for the thing, but be relaxed. Just be relaxed when you approach it. I think that just gives you that sort of edge.
I mean, you could be like Sehwag. I mean, let's go back to cricket.
Yeah.
Where he apparently would just sing songs in his head. Mm. He'll have a disconnected conversation. He'll never discuss the state of the game. Mm. You know, he would discuss, who kaun hai blue shirt mein, kaun hai other? Mm. You know, those kind of ridiculous conversations.
Yeah.
But it's very good relaxing technique.
Yeah.
Because don't be fooled.
Yeah.
Everybody thinks, oh, he's such a lucky batsman. No, bullshit. The guy's got a great eye, great reflexes.
Absolutely.
And the moment the ball is in the hand of the bowler and he turns, Sehwag is on. And then Sehwag is off.
Yeah. Yeah, that whole on-off thing.
Yeah.
That is probably absolutely important. And also pick your mini battles, you know, pick your mini battles within the thing. So if you're having an hour-long podcast or if you're having a microcast like I have, I think the most important thing is to understand what you're trying to achieve, but do it in a relaxed way. Look, the world is not going to stop, right? What you need to understand is just put everything in perspective and just enjoy yourself. I think just relaxing and trying to enjoy that moment is probably going to be creating a better outcome for you.
Yeah. What do you think, Silvery? Too much preaching from us? You've had enough?
No,
if you start sweating, tell us. He's just saying, I agree.
Yeah.
Let's start making more fascist statements. All people under 5 foot should be shot. You agree? Actually, that's what I really believe, huh, Sid.
All right, next one.
Sid is conveniently frozen. Frozen on the fascist point. Yeah, go on.
Oh, wow, he was.
But is he there or not?
Hi, Sid. Can you hear us?
Wake up, Sid. I dare say.
Okay.
Sid,
no worries. No worries. We'll be back. Okay, we'll do a tennis question before Sid comes back because there are other cricket questions otherwise. So, Girish Patil asks, will Djokovic complete a golden Grand Slam this year?
Oh, I mean, who can answer that? But if anyone can, it's him. I mean, it's just unbelievable. After that French Open final, forget what's happening at Wimbledon right now. He's not even being tested. But so far. But yeah, he's just special. So special. And yeah, he can win the Olympic gold as well. He's the most ballsy guy in tennis as well. I still supported his move to raise money for the Balkan referees right in the beginning of the first lockdown. He was criticized. They all got COVID. But the point of the matter was, his heart was in the right place. And he's really underrated. And I hope when history looks back at tennis, they put him in his right position. At the moment, for me, looks like, if not the greatest ever, definitely the top five greatest tennis players that have walked the earth. And this is coming from a man who's never played tennis. You missed the tennis question, Baba.
I love
it. Will Djokovic make the Golden Grand Slam?
What I really admire about Djokovic is his ability to take shit, man, from all Federer fans and Nadal fans.
Yeah.
Because he never really
says anything about that.
He's just quite amazing because he's quite hated. He, in fact, reminds me a lot of Ivan Lendl. In that sense, he's got that whole face, and Lendl was worse.
But Lendl was introverted. This guy's very extroverted. He does mimicry. He answers back. He's friendly. Speaks six languages.
He tries a lot. And plus, come out of a war-torn country, done really well. And
there you go.
Yeah. But he's somebody. I don't know. Who's your favorite, Cyrus?
Federer will always be my favorite because I just love the fact that guy who looks for me like a card player. He looks like a guy who plays bridge.
Yeah.
You see his upper body, there's no athleticism whatsoever. He's going to be 40 on August 8th. There's nothing. It's like Sehwag again, you know. Chris Gayle made a statement about Sehwag with his shirt off saying it was like a baby elephant. When God blesses people, certain people like a Sehwag or a Federer, it's just, you don't have a chance against them. Because everything tells you they shouldn't be playing any sport.
Mm.
And they must be so gifted that they can just go above you by sheer talent. So
it's very interesting. I know that you work out, and I know that people talk a lot about working out and stuff like that. By the way, I hate running. That's what I told Antariksh. And I love working out. I built a gym on top along with my brother, and we've been working out ever since the lockdown. What is important is that most people actually kind of have that swimmer's body paradox, which they never kind of get, because in the sense that they say, I want a body like Michael Phelps. That's why I'm going to start swimming. Okay, and the funny thing is that they don't realize that Michael Phelps has got a certain body type, which is why he's a really good swimmer. And it's a very...
And also, swimming 20,000 meters a day and eating all kinds of food and training with diligence, you can't just say, "Ha, mere ko ye pasand hai." It's not like a haircut.
Yeah,
I want to look... Yeah.
Absolutely. But yeah, I mean, for anybody
Federer...
Yeah, Federer.
No, but all three, these three guys have just, they killed off the competition. The whole generation that's followed is unable to break through. Zverev is struggling, you know, Medvedev is struggling. I mean, everybody. Let's see what happens at Wimbledon. Yeah. Team is injured. But they're nowhere in the picture, really. Yeah,
yeah, it's like the Australian cricket team of the 90s or something, no?
Yeah. Or the West Indies of the 80s and early 90s. Yeah. My favorite team.
Yeah.
I met them all, beta. I'll tell you that story on another day. Next
not
day,
bad. Man. Not bad. Not bad.
Yeah. I met my favorite king, the king, Viv. And it was exactly what I imagined, you know. Walking like that alpha male, but very nice guy.
Yeah.
You know, under all that. Yeah. They're just that swagger. I tell you, I know Hardik comes close to it. He's very Pollard influence. Yeah. But I got to tell you, Indians should not behave like West Indians. We just don't have that rhythm. I ever since Baba Sehgal came out with that rap video, the first one, Thanda Thanda Pani, I realized that let's, you know, hip hop, there's certain things, just leave it. It's not our thing. We got Bhangra, we got disco, we got lots of things we can do, yeah. But not the swag. The swag we don't have, man. What do you think, Silvery? Do we have the swag?
I think I...
No, especially here after Thanda Thanda Pani, you can't say that we have any swag. You're right.
There you go. Sorry, said you can't teach that. You got to be born in the West Indies to have that, you know.
But you know something, I do teach, I use the documentary on Mumbai rap as in one of my classes. That's pretty, because it actually shows how culture is transported and how people can get.
But it's,
It's a vice.
This generation, the gully boy generation, they've localized the rap in a more real way.
Yeah.
Okay, what we had in the 90s was ridiculous.
It was horrible.
Because when you become a parody, not trying to be a parody, you hit the big time. You can't go beyond that.
Yeah, absolutely. You become Weird Al Yankovic, basically, without realizing it.
Yeah. Yeah. But I mean, he's purposely doing it. That's the difference. Yeah.
Exactly.
Silver next?
All right. Yeah. All right. Next one is a comment that comes from Akshay Swami. He says, Cyrus says, and the Traveling Professor's Diary. This is the biggest crossover since Marvel and DC.
Oh, Jesus Christ. See, first of all, we've got people like Bruce Wayne coming onto the show. By the way,
huge influence. Comics.
Yeah, exactly. Like, I have to tell people that, you know, even though I work out and stuff like that, I'm the Clark Kent that did not become Superman. So, it just doesn't happen. It doesn't work. If you see my brother...
But that's the aesthetics. That's the aesthetics of workout. With a lot to do with genetics and how you're working out and your age, etc., etc.
Yeah.
But that working out per se is different. You work out. You don't have to work out so that you can win the next Olympia. That's a different process completely.
Yeah.
Don't start me about working out. I've become like a Brahmin when it comes to all that. Excuse my French. In the sense that the moment I find people coming into the gym with bad energy, I want to kill them. I want to throw them out. So that's bad leadership.
No.
But don't you find that in when you go back to a public gym, there's just so many people just come there because they're killing time. I mean, if you have to kill time, why can't you masturbate? You just go home.
It pisses me off, I'm telling you. I've kind of realized that maybe the short you need to really build in some effectiveness and efficiency in your workouts, because your body is a really intelligent thing, right? So you are always trying to fool yourself by being able to do the same movement in very simpler ways and stuff like that. So I genuinely feel that if you have the ability, by the way, before I forget, have you tried something called Wim Hof breathing? You might end up enjoying that.
Right now, I'm on Mobizox for my left shoulder pain and my right knee pain, because at 49, trying to squat and deadlift, and I have to be a little careful.
Yeah,
so I'm trying to figure out all that.
No.
Will the breathing help the pain?
Oh, yes, absolutely. I would go into a rabbit hole on Wim Hof and just check this fellow out. You love him. He's an amazing guy. He's a little foolish in the head. He's worn shorts and gone up on Everest. No, seriously. He's a nutter. He's a complete nutter. He's invented a breathing technique which has been tested out by science, because normally you see so much of nonsense on YouTube that a professor like me has to kind of figure out what's really working and what's not before I present it to anybody else. But this guy is the legit stuff. He's figured out a breathing technique that you can use for, especially just before a workout, or if you're trying to recover rapidly after if you've got some pain or inflammation.
Not just workout, we're talking about stress. Aren't these breathing techniques very good for like illness, stress, anxiety situation? Plane is delayed for 5 hours.
Yeah.
I'm one of those guys who gets very hyper about these things, These small things really get to my... I don't know how to explain it to you. I start walking faster, my hands start shaking.
Horrible.
Delays and lateness is something I've never been able to deal with.
Yeah, no, same. Maybe that is something which we share in common, because as a professor, you have to be the first in class. You have to come on time and stuff like that.
And if no one else comes into class, it's a horrible feeling.
It is a terrible
feeling. It happens in America where they can choose their subjects and professors. It does
not. It is a terrible feeling, especially if you've got, even in India, if you've got the first class of the day, right? Whatever time it is, 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, yaar, koi aata hi nahi hai pehle 10 minute. So
that Xavier 7:55 7:55 ka class tha. It used to have 9 people, and then by 8:15 8:30 there was like 40 people, and then by 9 house full.
Correct. Yeah. Exactly. And that's when you got to maintain your cool and be relaxed, because if you get all het up and upset, because I've seen professors do that, they get really upset when somebody doesn't respect their time and stuff like that. But that's a losing battle, because eventually what you're doing is that you're just impacting your delivery and for everything else.
It all comes back to the ego. If you can control the male ego, everything is good. Yeah? I take it personally all the time. Yeah. The only time I can't take it is the bloody driving a car. I just, my road rage is just getting worse. And now lockdown, I'm missing it. I hope the lockdown comes back. People are crawling all over with their cars and scooters and all here. It's all, you know, I mean, it's going to be terrible. Sid, I predict this. Now it's going to be a boomerang effect, because you've like, what is the right word? Like, rubber band effect, like the tsunami. You've kept people in and then you allow it to flow and it'll go boom the other way.
Yeah.
And we're going to have people. I know people who haven't moved their cars in my lane. They have not moved the car. You know what they do? They don't put the old-fashioned parts. They just put the engine on 2 minutes. You know? And you can hear the engine starting and the guy, he doesn't even move it. I even told the uncle, uncle, take it 3 feet and then reverse it back a little bit. At least give the car an experience of driving if you're doing it. So just hit the engine. Months have passed. And now it's going to go berserk. Oh, lockdown over. Yes. Mahabaleshwar.
No, I know. It's going to be the roaring 20s all over again. After the swine flu ended and the First World War ended, what happened was the roaring 20s, right? Wherein people just, it was the decade of excesses.
Until the depression of 29, right?
Yeah, until they burnt.
God is the ultimate comedian.
They burnt a lot of money.
Enjoy, beta. Vaccine. Mar jao. C'est la vie.
That's
I think the two professors have concluded their class. Should we do one quick, nice last one?
Yeah.
Yeah. What are the cricket questions? You had some.
1 second. There's one from Kashin Shetty. He says, hi, Cyrus and guest. If you got a chance to swap careers with a cricketer of your choice, who would you swap it with? Note, the cricketer has to be funny and you have to match all his skills.
Funny. Michael Vaughan is very funny. Indian cricketer, if I had to do, who's known to be funny, Harbhajan was supposed to be quite funny. Gavaskar was very funny. Pataudi was very funny, going back in time. Sid, please take it. Out of this present bunch, who's known to be
funny?
I think they're too now clinical.
Jesus Christ.
We don't see so much of that. Masti and all of the Bishan Singh Bedi era and all those guys.
Wasn't Yuvraj kind of funny?
They had some wild stories.
I think that
Yuvraj was laid back, but not exactly like the stand-up comedian of the team.
Yeah, I think the last genuinely funny guy I've seen was Sehwag.
Srinath was supposed to be very funny.
Oh yeah, that whole Venga Boys thing was quite fun.
Yeah. That's funny, but that's a put-on thing. I'm saying he was funny in the dressing room.
Was he?
He was the funny guy.
It does not come across as funny.
He was a class clown.
Yeah.
Not when he's bowling, but he always has a quick word for everyone. And so Jawagal Srinath would have been a good choice.
I would choose to be a guy called
Ray Bowler.
Ray Lindwall. He was funny.
Of course.
He was funny.
He was quick.
He was quick. And he could bat a bit lower down the order. So so I would probably choose him.
Going back to the Invincibles, then I'll take Keith Miller in the same team. Because Keith Miller's captaincy was, now you talk about leadership, famous. You know this story? So he would, New South Wales, he would, when he became captain for the first time, he'd go to the middle, lead the pack, and they'd say, okay, skipper, where have we failed? He'd just say, scatter. And take the ball and bowl. So this story was told.
Yeah. That was because, you know why, right? Because he'd actually was a pilot in World War II.
With two bullets in the back, yeah.
So there you go. And so he obviously must have thought of cricket as a lark. It's a scatter, now go.
Wow. It's another generation of cricketers. Gary Sobers also. Botham drinking and coming to bat. He came to Brisbane in a four-day game just before the Ashes in 86.
Yeah.
So he comes into bat. 8 down because they drank all night. So he put himself at 10. Gatting was the captain right at the back. He comes into bat and the Aussies are laughing at him. So he's a little angry. So what are you laughing at and all? And they said, "Where's your bat?" I mean, but these stories can't happen now. No? They're just so good with their work and work ethic and all that. Gone completely.
It's also media bites they've got, right? So that's also, you know.
I think they've taken themselves too seriously also. They kill the romance slightly. These stories. Wasim Akram, apparently Lancashire captaincy the first day. So the whole thing is you talk to the boys. And you're a foreigner there and all that. So they want to hear you talk. Mm. And so he's presented to everyone. And he looks at them and says, "Okay, come on!" And charges onto the field. That was his speech.
I love that. But
these are beautiful stories, yeah?
Yeah.
Leadership in one word. Give me the ball. I'm Wasim Akram. I'll take care of everything. I just have to hang around.
Wow. Very good. Cool. Wow. Okay. So this was unexpected and funny, man.
Yeah. I don't know if it was funny, but it helped pass 1 hour of my life and yours. Yeah. So that's a good thing.
That's always a good thing.
Want to end on a song? I want to end on a song question. Song-related question. Like a fun song.
Okay.
Song.
So it is not discuss music.
Just the song kind of.
I'm going to lose my internet.
Except Thanda Thanda Pani has been the only musical reference of this show, which puts us low down in the scale of music lovers and appreciators.
All right, this one comes in again from Bruce Wayne. He says, AMA for Cyrus and the chat and the guest. Guess the Hindi movie song. And this is, I'm going to quote the song now. It is, "Because you are a sophisticated rhetorician, intoxicated by the exuberance of your own verbosity."
Amitabh Bachchan, Amar Anthony.
Yes.
My name is Anthony Gonsalves. Main duniya mein akela hoon. Dil bhi hai khali. Ghar bhi hai khali. The one and only Amitabh Bachchan, man.
Wonderful.
There's nobody like him.
On a sad note though, we lost Dilip Kumar today. He passed away.
My phone was off.
Yeah, he passed away.
Suffering the last few years, no?
Yeah. I mean, he's struggling, I think. He was struggling.
That line in Shakespeare and Caesar about, you know, what's the point of old age, honestly? You see people starring titans and then you see someone and they just, you know, like that. Yeah. That's another podcast that we have to do.
Yeah.
How to end it with dignity.
Yes. Yeah. Dignity is required. No?
Professor Sid on euthanasia. I just see too many old people suffering too much. You know, there's nothing left. They're a shell of who they were. There's no mind. There's no physical ability. Then what is the point of just being alive?
Is that
wrong to say?
No, one of the biggest trends in Silicon Valley with guys like Peter Thiel and Elon Musk is that they're investing in extension of life and extension of youth, right? I mean, Elon Musk is actually getting the Neuralink thing going. So he's trying to extend the brain's capacities and you being able to upload brains and stuff like that. While on the
Plus
other
he's
hand,
moving. He's moving to the moon, so you know it'll be a different experience.
Mars.
Moon mera generation ka hai.
Peter Thiel is doing something really interesting, trying to extend life and extend whatever. So I don't know. I'm in two minds about it. I'm not sure.
No, listen. It's a positive development, I think, but it has to be quality of life as we have some value. Do you want to be that? You want to be that? You know, just you're like in a coma.
Yeah,
what's the point? The same guy, a great professor, a man of great intellect, a man of great energy, and then that's it.
Yeah.
It's almost cruel.
Yeah. No, absolutely. I agree with, let's say, a guy like Quentin Tarantino. I don't know if you saw the Joe Rogan episode, but he said he's going to quit at number 10. Film number 10. He's not going to do anything ahead because he doesn't want to be a caricature of his own self. So that's pretty interesting, sobering note maybe. But yeah, that's what my take is.
Wait, does he have enough money? Do we have enough money to quit the podcast?
Maybe.
I can give you a hot sandwich from Fountain. That to Dagubai gives me a discount, I think. 35 bucks for 40. It feels bad. Utke paas nothing nahi hai.
You got your chutney also, hai na, fir.
In the dustbin now, Baba. Plastic now, wife will come and see.
Yeah, that's life. Correct. Wonderful.
You can see I'm checking after making the reference. So you know I didn't lie. Body language is everything. You knew immediately. Yeah. Okay, guys. Listen, Sid, this has been great.
Yeah.
Let's talk again. Only let's do a cricket special, no? Next time.
Chalo, karte hai.
Yeah. I'm so happy I met someone got out to Tendulkar and caught Vinod Kambli.
So here's what we should do. What we should do is that we should talk about cricket wherein you get in the anecdotes and maybe I'll get in some laws from management or some shit like that which can get talked about in cricket. It could be a pretty interesting thing.
So we'll take cricket and make it boring. I love it!
Don't say that. Okay.
Let's do it. These parallels are fun.
Yeah,
this is an intellectual exercise. I love it.
We can make fun of all the fucking management principles. That's also another.
No, you're bang on. CLR James said, "What do they have cricket know? Who only cricket know?" Cricket is just we use cricket to explain other things.
Yeah, why not?
I mean, Jardine sat down and did a battle plan, you know, over in a restaurant somewhere in England to explain body line and leg theory.
We could start with that. Yes.
Yeah. Which, you know, when you look at it, pepper and salt, and it looks innocuous, you know. Yeah. And then when you actually just bowl into a ribcage and everybody's on that umbrella of the leg side, I mean, it must have been with good bowlers at good pace like Harold Larwood and Bill Woese, must have been really hard.
Yeah, it is hard. That era. It is hard. If it hurts.
Neil Wagner does a little bit of that. He tries to bowl in that exact line.
But
look how he got Rahane. I thought that was fabulous bowling.
I think Rahane, come on, man. What kind of a stupid shot was that, though?
No, but the ego he played with, na? Rahane was thinking, this is Wagner. This is not Wasim Akram. Mm. What the hell?
I think it's very, very...
There's a little bit of... He played with that ego a little bit. Because why didn't he play that shot to reach 50 or whatever, as Gavaskar pointed out?
Yeah.
He didn't play that shot.
Wagner is...
He could have just seen...
Wagner is a very talented, underrated bowler. Because he...
Underrated, yes.
He knows how to bounce. It's such a tough talent. And most people don't think of it as talent. They just look at it as fierceness or something.
And we are looking at length. I'm talking about line of short pitch bowling.
Yeah, absolutely.
The line of short pitch. Which is what Jardine's point was the line. Yeah, the length, everyone can understand after a point. Bowl short, hit his ribs. But you're hitting it at that blind spot area of the leg side here.
Yeah.
Leg to middle.
Yeah. He also looks a little like Bruce Willis.
Which is a skill.
He also looks a little like a younger Bruce Willis, is what I thought.
Garibo ka Bruce Willis.
Yeah.
But underrated is the team that is now the World Test Champion, is it not?
Yeah.
I mean, underrated would be the tag from start to finish. Those guys, unknown soldiers.
Yeah, man.
You can't even tell the names of the extras who played.
Absolutely.
And boom, they beat the best team in the world easily.
That's the go-to moment, yeah. That's the go-to moment for me.
That's the romance of cricket, bro.
Yeah. 100%.
So, you know.
100%. Good stuff.
Silvery hasn't said a word. Ever since Zaina Edalji quit cricket, he's never spoken again about the game. Chalo, guys. Okay, bye, Sid.
Bye.
Thanks for a good one.
Yeah.
See you, Silvery.
See you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Take it easy.
Okay, catch us on any of the podcasting apps, please. We beg you, we need you. Send us your questions on Twitter, on Cyrus Says In, or you can email us, even if you're not female, on whatcyrussays@gmail.com.
I hope you enjoyed that show. If you aren't following us on social media, please do. We're IVM Podcasts on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. I'd like to thank the sponsors on the network this week, SEAT, CRED, and Global Victoria. We thank you so much for making all of this possible. So this week on Cyrus Says, Tapsee Pannu was recently featured in the Netflix original Haseen Dilruba was on. They discussed her experiences in Bollywood and a whole lot more. On Begin the Journey, Ashish Vidyarthi enlightens us with his wisdom on how one can get freedom from their own thoughts or insecurities when they communicate with others. On The Millennial Athlete, Tanvi and Shlok fill us in on all the drama from the world of sports with Wimbledon, Euros and World Test cricket making headlines every day. On Postcards from Nowhere, Utsav Memoria kicks off a new series, Beneath the Veneer. We travel to the Hashemite Kingdom of Jordan, where he takes us through his first experience of encountering the Red Sea. We have a brand new show, Misconduct. It's a true crime show hosted by Raghvi, a lawyer, and Nisha, a PR pro. They tell us about the story of Cyanide Mallika, the lady who offered cyanide-laden sweets to women and after they die, loot their gold. On the Global Victoria Tech Talks podcast, we showcase some compelling new tech stories coming out of Melbourne. On one episode, Pawan Srinath speaks to Joe Agan from Nelnet International, where they discuss how the pandemic has affected the edtech sector and its evolution. Another episode has Varun Dugirala talking to Ross Simons from Big N Studios about the gaming ecosystem and how they envision translating a sport to a game. And with that, I hope to see you again next week.
Namaskar, dear friends. My name is Ashish Vidyarthi. Life, as you know, is a journey. And you and I, travelers, how can we celebrate this travel? I have a podcast for you, Begin the Journey. I share stories and moments from my life. Do tune in every Monday and Thursday to listen to my podcast on the IVM Podcast website, app, or wherever you get your podcast from. Cheers.